Hello everybody, it's the Historical Gamer once again, and today we're going to be doing something a little bit different. We're going to be talking about some gaming news. That's something I do on the channel every once in a while, but it's been a bit since my last episode looking at some gaming news. And the topic for today is going to be a new game which was just announced about 2 months ago. So it's not breaking news per se, but it is still topical, I think. There doesn't seem to be a ton of coverage out there for this. There's a couple of videos that talk about the announcement on YouTube. There is a sort of initial pre-alpha view of some of the gameplay on the developer's sort of second channel. And there's really very little out there in the traditional gaming media as well about this game. And despite all of that, it's a game that I think is intriguing. It is a game that we don't have a ton of other games in this sort of era. And I think a lot of you guys might find might be interested in it. So I figured, why don't I shed a little bit of light on this and share what very little information we know about the game. The game that we're going to be talking about is called Fire and Maneuver. Fire and Maneuver is being developed by Targon Studios, as well as both developed and published by Armchair History Interactive. And this appears to be the first game for Armchair History Interactive in terms of their existence. And there's something particularly interesting about Armchair History that we'll talk about in a moment. Fire and Maneuver appears to be a game that'll be a turn-based, hex-based war game that takes place during the 19th century, specifically between 1853 and 1871. That range is significant because at the beginning of that period, in 1853, you have the Crimean War, which takes place in Russia and also on the continent, between the Russian Empire on one side, and on the other side you have the Ottoman Empire, and then you have the European intervention with the French and the British. There's also the Kingdom of Sardinia, Piedmont, because Italy wasn't united yet. Plays a role. And I think Austria fought a little bit on the continent as well. But you have the Crimean War sort of in the front end of this period of history. And then on the back end of this period, you have the Franco-Prussian War, which was between the Kingdom of Prussia and then the German states that were still independent, essentially the North German Confederation, the South German Confederation. And it resulted in the unification of Germany under a single monarch. Kaiser Wilhelm, the first one. And this is a period of time that we really don't see very many games covering. The only sort of games that I really can think of that you ever see in this period focus on the other side of the ocean in the United States, looking at the American Civil War. And so that alone makes me excited about this game. Now, before we dive too much into the information about the game or the historical background, let's take a step back and talk about the developers of the game. So as I said, Targon Studios are listed as the developer on the Steam page. Targon has developed, at least on Steam, a total of two games, both from a couple of years ago and both very different than any kind of war game like what we would expect here. So they developed a game, The Haunting of Billy, and also Miss Squeaker's House for the Sick. And I don't know how to describe these games based on the screenshots as anything other than really weird looking and somewhat basic, not like overly complex, large, like, you know, 3D worlds or anything like that. So they have some experience developing games, although nothing that, as far as I can tell, developing war games. They do not appear to be the driving force behind this game, however. The game is certainly being led by the Armchair History Interactive, given the fact that the channel is really promoting it a lot. And it's actually the Armchair History Interactive is a, I don't know if you would call it a division, but it's part of the Armchair Historian, who is a YouTube channel that does history documentaries on their YouTube channel. And so, you know, they're clearly the ones behind this game. They have the name in the game. It's the Armchair Historian's Fire and Maneuver, like in some of the thumbnail art. So they're clearly the ones that are sort of financing or bankrolling this, I would assume. And then Targon, I am assuming, is the developer they've contracted to make the game. Now, the Armchair Historian, as I already said, is a YouTuber who does historical documentaries, kind of in the vein of like extra credits where they have, you know, a lot of animated things going on to kind of help tell the story that they're talking about. He tends to do stories or documentaries that are between 12 to 30 or so minutes long. At a wide variety of different topics, a lot of World War II stuff, a little bit of Civil War stuff, and actually some Crimean War and Franco-Prussian War stuff. And again, these are, you know, short little videos that give you a surface level understanding of a given conflict or a given battle. These aren't overly detailed. Again, if you're familiar with it, I think the first, you know, these kind of channels are really hot right now, or have been for a little while now on YouTube. These history documentary series. I would say the first one that really was kind of prominent, at least for my awareness, I don't watch a ton of this stuff, but for my awareness, was like the Extra Credits series, which had these, you know, kind of very appealing animations and a wide variety of topics that they would cover. The Armchair Historian is obviously doing his own thing and is focusing more on the military side of things within the documentaries. There's a lot of channels out there that do these kind of military history or history type documentaries, some of them good, some of them bad. I don't really watch the Armchair Historian stuff, but it's a big channel. He's got 1.4 million subscribers. His videos usually average anywhere between 500,000 to a little over a million views. It's a very successful channel. And what's really interesting to me about this is the fact that they're diving in to game development, not coding it themselves, apparently, but they are certainly, I would imagine, designing the game, and they are making Fire and Maneuver. And I don't think I can think of another YouTube channel that has developed their own games. I mean, way back when, before YouTube really was even a thing, you had the Strong Bad or the Homestar Runner series, that ended up spawning a couple of games. And then, you know, within the YouTube sphere, you have the Angry Video Game Nerd, who made and like had an 8-pixel like type Nintendo-esque kind of a video game made as well. But I mean, his channel is much larger, more than double the size of the Armchair Historian. One of the first really big channels on YouTube. It's like a 15-year-old channel. And so other than those examples, I can't think of anybody else who's got a YouTube channel who's developing games, unless they're a game developer first, who's just using YouTube to promote it. But I can't think of like any of these other history type channels or, YouTuber, you know, gaming channels where they've decided we're going to go off and make our own game. There's probably some, nothing I can think of. So that in of itself is interesting. You know, it'll be interesting to see how this game looks. We really don't have a lot of information about the game yet. It is still very early, at least in terms of what's being shared. The developer did post some gameplay footage. The game is in, I think, pre-alpha on their second channel, Behind the Armchair, which is, you know, I guess, a behind-the-scenes type channel about the Armchair Historian's stuff. And in that video, he did share some gameplay as it is today. It looks like it is, well, before we jump into that, so they have shared a little bit, but in terms of like what's on the Steam page, mostly it's just kind of animations or images that would almost look like it's out of the Armchair Historian's YouTube channel and not like gameplay in a game. There's a couple of screenshots of some pre-alpha footage, but what do we know about the game so far? Well, the game does appear to be looking at, as I already said, 1853, the beginning of the Crimean War, until 1871, the conclusion of the Franco-Prussian War. It's going to, initially at launch, it's going to include 5 playable nations, the Second French Empire, which is the French under Napoleon III, the North German Confederation, really led by the Kingdom of Prussia, the British Empire, Russian Empire, and Ottoman Empire. And so these are sort of the key players. The British and French obviously fought in the Crimean War against the Russians. The Ottomans were there as well. And then you have the North German Confederation and the Second French Empire again. This time they fought, you know, 18 years later in the Franco-Prussian War. And so those are the key combatants there. It does say that the Austrian Empire is going to be added post-launch. So they fought on the continent in the Crimean War. So that seems like a logical country to add to the game. And then apparently there's a seventh nation that's going to be added that will have expert mountain troops and political paramilitaries, but they lack professionalism. So they haven't said what country that is. I'm wondering if it maybe is Greece. You know, I thought maybe Sardinia, Piedmont, because they were another key combatant in the Crimean War, but they didn't really. I don't think they fit the lack of professionalism side of things. My thought was maybe it would be Greece, given they definitely had mountain troops and a considerable amount of mountain fighting, but they also were kind of involved in supporting revolts against the Ottomans during the Crimean War, and less like direct military invasions and things like that, per my understanding. And so you could potentially sort of mix this. We're going to inspire rebellion type, you know, paramilitary troops with, you know, mountain troops as well. So I guess maybe them. I'm not sure who else it would be. Just sort of an initial thought. But yeah, so those are the countries that are going to be involved. As I said earlier, it is a turn-based, hex-based war game. It does say it has turn-based combat with a twist. No plan survives first contact with the enemy, and FNM places you in the same position as historical generals, anticipating your opponent's movements. The game's innovative simultaneous turn system requires careful consideration of your opponent's previous actions. So basically, it sounds like they're going to have a WeGo system, which I like. There's not a lot of games out there that do WeGo. I Go, You Go is much more common, where you issue an order. The order is carried out. You issue another order, it's carried out. And when your turn is done, the other side gets to go. Simultaneous turn resolutions implies you issue your orders, the other side issues their orders, you both hit end turn, and then the orders get resolved simultaneously. And so that looks pretty cool. What I will say is, in the limited gameplay footage that they did share on Behind the Armchair, Griffin Johnson, who's the armchair historian, indicated that even though you issue your orders and then you know they're resolved, and then the other side resolves it all sort of at the same time-ish, there's still an order of operations that occurs, so it's not truly simultaneous resolution. You issue all your orders, hit submit, and then the orders that you issue are resolved in the order in which they were given. So you might issue an order to your 1st Brigade, your 2nd Brigade, and your 3rd Brigade. And so those orders then will unfold with the 1st Brigade moving first, the 2nd Brigade moving next, the 3rd Brigade moving next. So it kind of isn't WeGo, but it kind of is, I guess. It'll be interesting to see how that plays out. One of the other things that I also noticed, and this isn't on the Steam page, so I guess this is breaking news if you haven't seen the video on Behind the Armchair. But apparently the game has no dice mechanics in it, which is different from these kind of games. It is going to have like predetermined results, I guess. So depending on the formation that you're in and the orders that you issue, like if you issue your troops to fire at the enemy, it will always, if you have like a full brigade or whatever of your troops or whatever the unit size are, it will always remove one cohesion from the enemy if you do a volley straight on to another enemy line. If you flank them, it will do 2 damage. And then once the cohesion runs out, then you start actually killing enemy troops or in companies. So every unit is made up of companies. And every time you do 1 point of damage, it'll remove 1 company as KIA if there's no cohesion to absorb the damage. If you do 2 points of damage, it'll remove 2 KIA. But the amount of damage you do, you will know ahead of time. Again, 100%. There's no dice rolls. And so based on what Griffin was saying there, it's going to be very easy for you to understand what's going to happen in a given interaction based on the order that you are giving. And so now, obviously, you won't know what the enemy is going to do to you. So there is still that element of mystery there. But it is, I'll say that's different, I think. Generally, these kind of games, there's always some form of chance, you know, Panzer General or other turn-based games like Unity of Command, they'll give you an estimate of casualties, an estimate of damage that's being done, but you won't know for sure. And in a board game, you won't either. You'll roll a dice. And so you might have odds that you can make decisions based on, but they're just that, they're odds and things can go wrong. So this is definitely, I think, a different, a mechanic that I'm not as familiar with. So I don't know that I love the idea of knowing exactly what's going to happen. Like, do you really know how many musket balls are going to slam into your opponent's ranks before you issue the order to fire? But from a game perspective, it could be kind of intriguing. I guess we'll see what that looks like. It's certainly different. And I'm generally a fan of developers that try to do things that are different. The game clearly seems to be battle-centric, so I don't see like any campaign maps or anything like that anywhere in anything that we've seen so far. You know, the footage that's been shared on the armchair, behind the armchair, was all within the realm of an individual battle. The screenshots, such as they are on the Steam page, all appear to be within individual battles. And so it's, I think, primarily going to be focused on tactical battles. The game's overview does reference some kind of campaign. So it says, basically it says, find yourself plugged into Victorian warfare where every moment seems to bring some new tactical or technological innovation. Forget about such matters as politics and economic affairs. So you'd think that means no grand strategic campaign. As your sole purpose in FNM is military victory. Fight against your friends in recreations of historical battles, so that's tactical battles, or else forge a new path for Europe as you veer off the tracks of history. Carefully consider whether to push your campaign offensively or cede the initiative to your opponent, as constant offense will drain your precious resources. So there does seem to be a resource element to the game. It sounds like there will be some kind of campaign. I don't know if that means it's going to be more like grand, you know, Ultimate General, where units, you know, fight in battles, but they're sort of predefined battles, or if it's more open-ended. But it doesn't sound like there's no politics in it, so I would imagine it's somewhat scripted. There is a customization element here where it says as you win battles and earn renown, you'll unlock the ability to create your own regiments and bring them to the battlefield. So that sounds a little bit like the Ultimate General series, where you, as you level up your command, you're able to manage your own forces and raise new units and assign them new names and commanders and equipment and things like that. So that sounds similar to that. But that, like, that's almost the limit of what we know. We know the game has multiplayer. Apparently it's going to have leaderboards and rankings for online multiplayer. But I don't know what the single player really looks like. They haven't really shared. You know, the only things they've shared are this brief overview, which I've pretty much already read the whole thing from, the turn-based combat mechanic that I just talked about, the factions that we already went over, the fact that it has multiplayer, and then this customization element, which apparently there will also be microtransactions where you can buy, like, skins and things like that for your units. So that could be... I would imagine for some folks that would be appealing to be able to buy like customized uniforms and things like that. But on the flip side, like, it's very adamant. There's no loot boxes. You're not going to be playing to win. Like, it's not going to affect the combat value of your troops, presumably. But yeah, I mean, that's kind of all we know at this point. So I'm curious. I guess we'll see what comes of this game. I will also say that I think this is, I mentioned it before, but I really think it's an interesting topic and an interesting era of combat. You know, I think especially living in America, we so often focus on the American Civil War as like, it was the first modern war and you had trenches and you had the beginning of repeating weapons and machine guns and were beginning to be developed, although not really deployed all that really much. But like the Gatling gun was in theory developed. And you had like the Spencer and the Henry repeaters. So you were moving away from the sort of single shot muskets of the Napoleonic eras. And you had the rifled muskets with the longer range, making combat much more deadly and making, you know, linear combat in open fields absolutely a bad idea, as Lee learned at Pickett's Charge and Malvern Hill. But on the flip side of that, we often ignore the Crimean War, where the British and the French and the Russians learned all those same lessons. They learned all about siege warfare and how the increasing lethality of weapons was making linear combat in open fields obsolete. The British completely decimated cavalry charges using long-range fire from their Enfield rifled muskets, which, incidentally enough, were weapons that were heavily imported and used in the American Civil War. And so the British were learning this already. They knew this. If anything, the British were better at using their weapons at long range than the Americans. They trained to a high proficiency of firing on a parabolic trajectory so that they could engage at much greater ranges than the Americans ever trained to engage in the Civil War. And so they already knew most of the lessons that the Americans learned in the Civil War, with the exception of maybe moving units around via railroad. But the, and then by the end of that period of time, by the 1870s, the Franco-Prussian War, you know, you have, rapid firing weapons like the needle gun, you have breech loading artillery, steel breech loading artillery. So it's not, you know, no longer just bronze cannon and stuff like that. And so by that period, that was one of the first really large scale industrial wars where hundreds of thousands of troops are raised. And, you know, it set the stage for the developing of the Schlieffen Plan because the Germans realized we can't do this again. There's too many troops and too narrow a space. Weapons are getting too deadly. You know, we had some key advantages over the French, but that's not going to happen again. And so we need to flank them and move through Belgium. And that's kind of where the Schlieffen Plan comes up. Meanwhile, the French, their entire policy for the next 40 years is based on revenge and trying to get Alsace-Lorraine and the lost provinces back from the Germans. And so, you know, you could certainly make the argument that the Crimean War and the Franco-Prussian War after that were definitive conflicts in the era that set the stage and sort of for World War One in many ways, and less so the importance of the American Civil War. And so I think, you know, this is a long-winded way of me saying, I think it's a really interesting period of time. I don't think games focus on it enough. We really don't get many games that cover this period. The only games I've ever played in this era are American Civil War games, which are fine and great and I enjoy. But I do think these conflicts are equally important, if not more so, and they often get overlooked in the gaming space. And so it's cool to see that they're going to be covered. I'm curious what we'll see here in terms of the game, the lack of dice, the sort of hybrid WeGo type approach, and question marks around what is the single player experience look like? I don't know. So yeah, that's the news that we have about Fire and Maneuver. The Steam page says it'll be released in Q4 of 2021. So that's right around the corner, folks. That's in just a few days. Not the game coming out, but the quarter starting anyway. Yeah, so let me know your thoughts, guys. Is this something you're excited about? What are your thoughts? Do you really think it's going to come out in Q4? Like for a brand new group's first game ever? You know, I would not shock me if there were delays. So I guess we'll see. But yeah, let me know your guys' thoughts. I'm curious to hear your opinion. Is this a game you're looking forward to? Did you know about this game or did I help to make you aware of it? Because I'm always a little bit nervous, especially for a game like this. You know, it was announced 2 months ago. Like, what value am I adding by talking about this and sort of going over this? And I guess at the end of the day, I figure it's worth it because I don't see anyone else talking about it. And I assume it's something that you all might be interested in. But, you know, I don't know how closely you all follow general gaming news and press for things like that. There's not a lot of that stuff on YouTube for this, the types of games that we play. And so if you only watch gaming stuff on YouTube and you never go to like the wargamer.com or other places like that to get gaming news, then what I'm doing here has some value. If you do both, then it may not, but I'm curious to hear what your guys' thoughts are. Anyway, that's enough of me rambling. Leave your thoughts down below in the chat, and I'll take a look at them, and I hope you guys have a great day. Until next time, this is the Historical Gamer, as always, saying once again, thank you very much for watching, and until next time, I'm out.